Okay, you have to wait for the fan to go off.
That's too bad, but...
Somebody just went outside. Oh. They should unplug it. Okay, can we start?
Yeah.
Thanks. Hey, thanks everybody for being at our press conference today. I'm Scott Psyche. I'm the Speaker of the Hawaii House of Representatives. This pandemic has exposed that we cannot do business as usual. We've heard from our constituents who are uncertain and afraid time after time. That's why during this pandemic, the House has taken a more proactive role in helping the executive branch to launch and implement new initiatives. I'm grateful for our partners who have worked over the past few weeks to stand up two mass vaccination centers on Oahu, Hawaii Pacific Health, the Queen's Health Systems, City and County of Honolulu, and the State Department of Health. They've helped to make today's official launch a reality. This mass public vaccination effort is emblematic of how government needs to work in the future. Just roll up our sleeves and get it done. People just want action and results. I want to thank those who are here today, including colleagues from the House of Representatives. First, I have Representative Linda Ichiyama, who chairs our House Pandemic and Disaster Preparedness Committee, and Representative Aaron Ling Johansson, who chairs our Commerce and Consumer Protection Committee. They responded to my call and jumped into action with me to take on this important mission. I'd also like to introduce and acknowledge Brooks Baer and Ron Balahadio from the Department of Health, who are here to represent Dr. Libby Char. Unfortunately, Dr. Char is testifying as we speak before the House Finance Committee, so she could not be here today. To share more information about the community vaccination centers, are Ray Vara, President and CEO of Hawaii Pacific Health, Dr. Jill Hargard Green, the President and CEO of the Queen's Health Systems, and the Mayor of the City and County of Honolulu, Rick Blangiardi. And the first person that I'd like to call on is Ray Vara from Hawaii Pacific Health. And I just want you to know that when this initiative began, Ray was just a bulldog and just helped to drive this program for us. So I'd like to call in Ray.
Thanks, Speaker. Before I talk a little bit about why we're doing this and why it's so important, which hopefully is obvious to folks, I really have to extend a thanks to the Speaker for his leadership, along with Representative Ichiyama and Johansson's. They've just been fantastic leaders in helping us remove barriers to be able to move this forward. As well as we got to thank the Department of Transportation leadership and the Department of Health leadership. And so when we started really envisioning this, we knew the priority was to get shots in arms. Frankly, at the end of the day, and we look forward to the future of Hawaii, that's really the most important thing. And so within Hawaii Pacific Health, our mission is to create a healthier Hawaii. And one of the things we know that's much bigger than just the things that we can do within the walls of our facilities. It includes all the elements of public health, which we've all have been talking about for the last 10 months, but it also includes the economic health of the community. And the quickest way to resolving a true state of health of the population is to get people vaccinated. And so we're really excited about this. Again, our primary goal at this site is to get shots in arms. We're gonna do it in an efficient way, in a coordinated way, and consistent with guidance from the Department of Health as we work our way systematically through the phasing process so we can work our way through the entire community. I also want to thank our partners at the Queens Medical Center who are going to be standing up their site in short order. And without their partnership and visioning through this, we wouldn't be standing as a community of health officials to really move this and advance this in a meaningful way that's going to allow us to vaccinate our population over the coming months. So for this site here, which you'll get a chance to walk through once we finish the conference or the press conference, we're going to be operating it beginning next Monday, on a Monday through Saturday basis by appointment only. And so we're going to be able to systematically, at the start of it, get somewhere north of 1,000 people through a day, ramping up in the next few weeks to somewhere between 3,000 and 4,000 a day. And so again, we're really excited about this. We see it as a significant advancement as we look forward to restoring public health to our community. Thanks, Speaker.
Thanks, Ray, and to the HPH team. Our next presenter is Dr. Jill Hargard-Green, who is the CEO at the Queens Health System. Their vaccination center will be at the Neil Blaisdell Concert Hall. And I just wanted to let you know that when we started this initiative a couple weeks ago, Jill was just kept telling us, we are going to get shots in arms, we're going to do this, we're going to get this done, we're going to vaccinate Hawaii. And that was the spirit that just helped us to carry us through this process. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Jill Green.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you all of our government partners and as health systems, and Ray has said it so beautifully. We've seen the impact of this devastating disease, and we know the route to getting in front of it is vaccination. So there is nothing more important to us as we want to improve the health of all individuals in Hawaii at getting everyone vaccinated. Both our partners at Hawaii Pacific Health and other health systems have been vaccinating their essential workers. But we're ready, and we're ready to expand. Yesterday, our team at Queens vaccinated over 1,000 people. And as they did that, were joyful, and that's in one day. Now, we found that that's all the people we could actually serve in one day in our existing environment. So we are so grateful to the leadership of the speaker, because what we need is more space, beautiful environment that keeps it safe for everyone, and then an ability to scale up to be able to meet the needs of the community. We are very excited and delighted to partner with Hawaii Pacific Health and with Ray's team. They are starting on Monday, as you've heard. You're going to see a beautiful site. We start a week from Monday at the Blaisdell, and we'll continue with them as we go to make sure that every individual has the ability to be vaccinated to protect and improve the health of the people we serve. As a nurse of 40 years, this is one of the most important things we can do. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Green. You know, I wanted to also just add that when we began this process a few weeks ago, we actually went on some site visits to with Queens and HPH to for them to select a site, and they, HPH and Queens, came forward to us. We did not go to them. They came to us and asked if they could assist the state in maximizing and expediting vaccinations. Our next presenter is Mayor Blangiardi. And you know, when we did, I mentioned that we held some site visits. And when we went to the Blaisdell a couple of weeks ago, you know, Mayor Blangiardi and his team said right off the point, they said, we will make the Blaisdell available to you. And they never flinched, and they said, we're gonna make it work no matter what. And that's why Queens was able to choose the Blaisdell Concert Hall as its venue. So I'd like to introduce Mayor Blangiardi.
Good afternoon, thank you. Well, first of all, I wanna thank Speaker Psyche, and thank you for those kind words, but never a doubt. Also, I wanna thank the Queens Medical Center, Dr. Green, and my good friend, Mr. Ray Vara, Hawaii Pacific Health, for being here. You know, this truly demonstrates what it means to be one team. So I'm very excited about this opportunity. And look, the more efficiently we can distribute the vaccines, the faster we can get the city and county of Oahu, or Honolulu rather, going again. But this means a lot for our island. So whether it's securing the Blaisdell, providing personnel, or any other support that the city can give to get our people vaccinated, to move us forward, you can count on us. Thank you.
All right, thanks, Mayor. We'd like to take questions at this point. Is there any questions? We also have the Health Department here to take any questions you may have. Stuart.
Can you give a sense of when, especially given what this might accelerate in terms of getting shots in arms, when we could expect to move really into the 1B category and then into the 1C category? Do we have a time frame for that?
Yes,
and can you explain what 1B and 1C are?
Thanks, Stuart. Good question. So 1A is medical personnel and as well as long-term care residents and staff. 1B is made up of essential workers and those over 75 years of age. And phase 1C is made up of those over 65 years of age and those who have conditions that may put them at higher risk. And then everyone else fits into category 2 or phase 2. And so we are, this site essentially has us launching what would be concurrently with 1A, 1B. And so we have, throughout the course since last night, have been scheduling appointments for those 75 and older going into next week for this location, as well as we will continue to do the affiliated medical personnel, those who aren't necessarily associated with a hospital like dentist, freestanding rehab therapist, as well as essential workers as designated in 1B by the Department of Health. And so we'll continue to move through that process at a pace based on our ability to throughput, as well as a pace that is made possible by the availability of vaccine that is coming into the state.
So by the time we get to 1C, any idea of when that could be? And then also just another quick thing, you mentioned 3,000 to 4,000 a day here. What about at the Blaisdell? So could we get a collective number?
We assume we're going to start at 2,000 and we hope to be up to 3,000 to 4,000 within a week or two. Part of this is trying out the process and seeing, particularly with Kupuna, what support they need. I think both of our goals is to be at least 5,000. But that's a stretch, and we need to work through that. But I anticipate 2,000 to 4,000 will be very reasonable from both parties once we scale up and we're ready to go.
But a goal of 5,000 each, so maybe as many as 10,000 a day each.
That would be our goal. But it will take staging, and we're going to really watch as we think about these first two groups. There are some very frail elders, and we have to go at a pace that's very supportive of them and assuring it's safe and effective. So if the numbers are 2,000 and it's the right pace for our elders, we'll be doing that. But know that we're going to do everything we can with these beautiful spaces, and I'm so appreciative of the mayor to make the Blaisdell available to us to have as many clinicians as possible to treat as many patients appropriately as we go through this work.
So to be clear, anyone that is 75 or older or a frontline essential worker can go to either location?
They can.
And how can they sign up?
You will see on our websites ways to get to our scheduling. So on ours, we'll be bringing that up early next week because we're a week out behind where our partners are. And Ray, if you want to describe your method today.
Thanks, Jill. We're using an appointment system. We've sent that out to a population thus far of those who are 75 and older, and they can self-schedule online. Like I said, we have somewhere just south of 1,000 folks who have scheduled appointments already beginning last night through today. And then we're also waiting from DOH designated essential services, which are eligible to be vaccinated, and then they can sign up via our website as well through online.
So how did you contact them?
What's that?
How did you contact them? You said
we
contacted reached out to them.
Those through our electronic medical record, who we had contact. We randomly selected a subset of that. because we can't have everybody trying to schedule at once.
Via
and we
email,
also want to leave capacity
phone.
For next week for essential workers.
Via email, via phone, how did you reach out to them?
Through an electronic message, through their electronic medical record.
Okay, and then those who didn't get that, do they just have to wait until they're contacted, or when will your site be posted so they can actually go and sign up?
Yeah, do you want to talk a little bit specifics? Let me introduce Dr. Ashton, who is really the one running all the things, and she can talk to much greater detail.
Thank you. So as Ray said, we're already able to reach out to some of our own folks who are on our own electronic medical record. Additionally, we have already had a process in place for what we call the Tier 1A non-affiliated. So as was described, dentists, rehab therapists, others in the community who don't have a tie to any of our hospitals. And so we have a place on our website where they can come in, indicate interest on a form, or an email address where they can indicate interest. They sort of raise their hand, say, I want some, and then we reach out to them. We have experience on the first day that we tried to vaccinate our employees of crashing a phone system. So we absolutely understand that not everybody is tech savvy and can do these web links and so forth, but to get the first blush out there, we think that this is the way to go without crashing a phone system. So, and we also understand that the Department of Health will have on their website a link to our link to help people get in. So basically it's a pretty simple, you know, fill in a couple of items on a form and then we will contact them.
Okay, and what is that link? Is it HawaiiCOVID19.com? Is that how people sign up?
I don't know what the Department of Health link is. That sounds right to me. Is that right, Bruce?
That's our website, and we will be posting first the RAISE link there, and then if Queen comes online, we will post their link there as well. So
that may be the simplest way, is to go to the Department of Health.
Okay. And so when do you think people that aren't contacted by you will start to be able to sign up? I'm sorry if I'm asking so many questions,
no.
But we are getting inundated with questions. People 75 and older, they want to know.
There's a great deal of interest. We're all being inundated. I think everybody has compared notes, and we understand the level of interest. Our website is live now.
And then the link is called what?
I don't know the specific name of it, but if they just come on the HawaiiPacificHealth.org website, the landing page, they will see what they need to see.
And I believe we posted that on HawaiiCOVID19.com as well. So if you go to HawaiiCOVID19.com, we'll find a link to Dr. Ashton and the APA's registration.
And are both appointments scheduled at the same time? Do you get the first appointment and then your second appointment?
No, the second appointment is scheduled at the time you receive your first vaccination. So you schedule your first appointment, you come in, you get your vaccination, and we will help you schedule the second.
And then last night, Ed Case was very critical of the speed in which the state is moving to launch these vaccination sites. How do you respond? He said we were one of the lowest in the country.
Well, we've been hampered by the fact that we have not been able to anticipate how much vaccine we can get. So until we were able to be certain that we would have vaccine, there's no point in setting up a site if you are not able to honor the appointments that you're giving. So we are now at a point where we have enough vaccine that we can open this up and be safe and know we can give vaccinations.
Maybe you could.
We should also mention that there are other pods that will be running both through other healthcare facilities will continue, as well as Department of Health will be running pods. These are just large mass vaccination sites, and so there will be other opportunities as well. And even at this site, you know, we've been fortunate that, you know, Kaiser Permanente has offered to send some of their folks down to help staff. So the whole intent of these is to get as many shots in arms as possible, as quickly as possible. And so that's the effort that we're trying to make here.
You mentioned the number of vaccinations that are available. I believe it was last week there was about 80,000 of those on island, but yet we've only given out between 40 and say 50,000 at this point. So can you talk about the challenges once the state gets them to getting them in the arms? What you mentioned phone system crashing, maxing out on the number of vaccinations you could give a day. So why haven't we given out all that we have?
Well, I can't, you know, that may be better for DOH to speak to. I can tell you with the vaccines that we've received, for our personnel, so for phase 1A and the affiliated medical providers. We have been executing on that. We've been delivering those. And the only thing that we are holding in reserve right now is to make sure that we have the ability to have the vaccine available, not knowing what's coming in the next couple of weeks, to pull this off over the next couple of weeks without concern. And so, you know, that does count for probably just shy of about 20,000 of those that folks believe that have not been necessarily put out into people's arms. But frankly, we knew the kind of volume that we were going to receive when we made this available, and we wanted to make sure that for the next couple of weeks we have the ability to utilize this space and this capacity to be able to vaccinate as many of our kupuna as possible and as many of our essential workers as possible.
So to make clear, you have 20,000 that you'll be able to roll out?
We have 20,000 right now sitting in freezers within Hawaii Pacific Health to use at this site. You know, when you think about this, I mean, there's a lot of people who will wonder why things haven't gone faster and how they could have gone faster. But there are rate limiting, you know, steps. One, you've got to make sure that you sequence through the appropriate phases, which were put in order for good reason. There are certainly not the unknowns of how many vaccines we're actually going to receive. And so you've got to be able to care for those who get the initial dose and make sure you have that available for those who are getting the second dose. And, you know, there's space limitations. There aren't a lot of spaces like this that are available that organizations like ours, like Quinn's, like others can occupy and funnel folks through. I can tell you, having been witnessing my team over the last couple weeks now preparing for this, it is a significant logistical challenge, but one certainly worth doing. We're going to think of all the people that we've talked about. We've talked about, you know, 1,000 plus to 3,000 to 4,000 plus funneling through this parking area, funneling through this building. You'll see the extent of the setup that we have behind these walls. And so we're really excited. And I think Hawaii is poised to really be at the tip of the spear of doing mass vaccinations as we work our way through the phases in a systematic way, as long as we have the space and as long as we have the vaccine available. Because I will tell you, between us and Queens and Kaiser and the other health systems that have all leaned in to make this work, there's certainly a will to get it done. And nobody is asking what's in it for them or who's going to pay for this or that. Our only goal is to get shots in arms. And we think if we do that, we're going to end up on the right side of the equation.
So it sounds like right now you have enough to get started, but right now there's not enough for all of Hawaii's seniors that if they all wanted to get vaccinated. And you mentioned that you were concerned because you don't know what's coming.
Well, I'm always concerned about what I don't know is coming. So that's one of the things I get paid to do, is make sure I look out and look around corners. But we don't have enough today. If we wanted to vaccinate all, if we had the space and the resources to vaccinate everybody today, we do not have all the 75 and above. We do not have enough vaccine in stock today. We do anticipate that we will have a flow of vaccine coming in week after week. But the last thing we want to do is schedule thousands of people. Because I can tell you, I've personally witnessed this with our own employee base and others that I've spoken to leading up to this. As soon as they get a call and they know it's their turn and they schedule that appointment, their shoulders drop about 3 inches and they exhale. There's a burden that is placed on people that we don't even recognize in our day-to-day activities. And so the fact that just being able to make that call or make that appointment available, the last thing we'd want to do is have to say, sorry, we don't have the vaccine, we got to reschedule you.
When you say we don't have enough, I assume you're talking about Hawaii Pacific Health, but can we get somebody from the Department of Health to tell us what is the number today that we have, because it's more than 90,000 from what I've heard, How many are on the way, and when are those coming? Because we hear that's more than the 114,000 that we hear we have.
How's it, everybody? Thanks. Be happy to answer that question. For those of you who don't know, you probably, I worked with a lot of you, so it's great to see you all here. Thank you very much. I'm Brooks Baer, and I am with the Department of Health, and Ron Balahadia, who is our immunization chief, is also here. And if there's anything that I can't answer, perhaps Ron can, and if we can't answer it here today, we will certainly do our best to get back to you. And while I'm at it, thanks for all your patience while we've been working so hard to fulfill all your requests. You guys have been great partners in getting information out there, and events like this, Speaker, thank you, are really important in us conveying our message, so thank you very much. Stuart, you asked about the vaccinations on hand, yeah? I can tell you that in the last 7 days, we have ordered more than 55,700 doses of both Moderna and Pfizer. And typically, the deliveries happen several days later. We have a rhythm where we often will order on a Thursday, and we will receive that vaccine then the following Monday or Tuesday. So the vaccines are coming. It is fabulous to know that HPH has 20,000 ready to rock and roll when this place opens. It is even better to know, or at least equally as good to know, that Queens and Jill Hager Green vaccinated 1,000 people yesterday. Thank you so much, Queens and HPH, for doing that. That's just fabulous, because our effort is to get shots in arms. And Paul, I know you asked about this perceived pace, yeah, of vaccinations. And I'd like to answer that in just a minute. But first, why is the spokes guy for Department of Health here, and where is the director? Speaker Psyche already mentioned that Dr. Char is not here today because she has to attend a finance committee meeting, a House Finance Committee meeting that was scheduled before this press conference. And so she is there trying to deal with budget issues that hopefully will benefit us all as we work deeper in this COVID-19 effort. And standing in this building where, unfortunately, I've never been before, in a cruise ship terminal, kind of plays with this analogy of the way Department of Health looks at this effort involving these two wonderful partners, Queens and HPH, and the legislature and the mayor. We kind of see what's going to happen here as the cruise ship. If you imagine it as a cruise ship, the Department of Health is providing the ship, it's providing the fuel, but our wonderful partners are providing all the crew, and they're going to pilot this ship for us. So it's kind of a symbolic place to be. And looking at all the open space, people will be able to distance here. There's ample parking and traffic flow, so that's all fabulous. Message from Dr. Char was that we have been working very hard to administer vaccines in a safe and secure manner. The goal is and has been to increase opportunity for people to receive COVID-19 vaccines. And the Department of Health has really been working extremely hard on several fronts to achieve that goal. And this is something that Ray Vera talked about earlier. Additional pods will be open. In fact, other pods are already open. And let me walk through, if I may, some of the things that have already happened up to this point to get us to the number of vaccinations, which is more than 40,000 that have already been administered. As has been talked about, there are different phases. There's phase 1A, phase 1B. Phase 1A, as has already been articulated, is the healthcare workers and the residents of long-term care facilities. The long-term care facilities, okay, that's one place we've been administering vaccine, and that's through our wonderful partners at CVS and Walgreens. The smaller long-term care facilities are being handled by the independent pharmacies, and the FQHCs, the Federal Qualified Health Centers, we're working in partnership with them to administer vaccine at their locations. So those are places where vaccines are already being administered. Pods, we're at a future site of a pod. Pods have already been open for a while. The hospitals are closed pods, described as closed pods, where their employees can come and get their vaccinations.
If I could interrupt, just yeah. And to focus back a
sure.
little bit more on the question. So of the 55,000 doses you've ordered
yeah.
in the past 7 days, how many have arrived and are they here? And is that in addition to how many we had before that?
Okay, so as of yesterday, we had a little more than 109,000. I can give you the exact number. And then more were expected today. And Ron, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe tomorrow, thousands more.
Yes, okay.
So, but back to the idea of pods. This is going to be a wonderful opportunity. But the pods have already been operated. We've had pods in the hospitals. I was at a Windward pod yesterday. They were administering more than 300 second shots there yesterday.
We should focus it on what's happening.
Yeah. I just want to, I've received a lot of questions about.
Any questions on this facility and the Queens facility?
Can you, why are the governor and the lieutenant governor not here?
What was the question?
Why are the governor and the lieutenant governor not here? It's all the questions that you guys.
They're represented by the health department today.
Can you talk about the procedures in place to ensure that there are no wasted doses? Like if people maybe sign up and then they don't show up or for some reason don't make their appointment?
You raise a really important point. And when you think about particularly the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine, we have to thaw them out. And they are really precious vials when they have those vaccines. So let's go back to, I said we had 1,000 people yesterday that we vaccinated. When you look at the number of vaccines available, double it, because each person needs two. So when we say there's 20,000, that means 10,000 seniors. When we're unfreezing, one of the important reasons we're scheduling is getting a very clear understanding of the depth of the number of people that are going to come on that day. I know that with Ray's team, led by Dr. Ashton and our team at Queens, we actually have pharmacists on site. So we carefully count the number of vials that we're going to bring to the site. We have a way of thawing them, but we are extraordinarily careful about when you bring out the next tray, because what you don't ever want to do is waste a drop. So that's the reason we're scheduling, is to have a pretty good idea to say how many people come. Now let's say folks didn't come. So far, we have not run into that problem. We anticipate that there will be frequently not just the person that comes, but their loved one that brought them to. So I'm not concerned that we will run out, that we will have to waste. I'm concerned that we'll run out. So we'll know that part of, we truly appreciate your partnership and the partnership with the mayor and the speaker. These first 2 to 3 weeks as we open up, we'll be adjusting to the number of people who really come when they're scheduled. And ensuring that we don't waste a drop. And on both sides, we're very careful about that.
Can you also talk about some of the efforts in place to combat, you know, misinformation or vaccine hesitancy? I know that poll came out that said, or the study came out that said only 44% are interested in taking the vaccine. Can you talk about kind of those efforts communications-wise?
Yes, you ask a really good question, which is, how do we help educate and inform people about the importance of this vaccine? And there is a lot of misinformation out there. And I know some people are scared and are saying, I'm going to wait till I see my family member get it to see whether I want to get it. Again, as a nurse of 40 years, I was delighted. I had tears in my eyes when they delivered the first, we call it the pizza box, which is where the vaccines came to our hospital. And we had our caregivers go first. But as soon as our caregivers were through the list, I was the first one in line saying, I'm ready based on our prioritization to have my vaccines. I believe in them. I think it's critical. I believe it's critical, and the science would say it. If you look at the studies of what we're done, and we have a wonderful physician here. As a scientist, I read the studies. When you looked at individuals that weren't vaccinated in the trials, there were 167 people who got COVID. Of the people who were vaccinated, it was 8. They are working. They're making a difference. And again, with Ray and Dr. Ashton, we see the devastation. We see the people that are in the ICUs. We will do everything we can to educate. So I know both of our systems are educating our patients and our families. We will be partnering with the mayor and the Department of Health and speaker to send any information possible. And we'll have some targeted communications, particularly to Kupuna, about the vaccine and how we're doing it so safely so that they're confident that when they come, we're here to help. Thank you. Thank you for the question.
I know you were talking about what's going on here. We had a question on when the Kupuna on Neighbor Islands will get these vaccines. Do we have any idea?
That's a good question, and I will share that we have a facility, and so does Hawaii Pacific Health, that are on other islands. So our North community is actually starting their first 1Bs because they have vaccinated all of the existing caregivers. So we are, as quickly as we have doses, they're going to the islands in the same proportion, at least from our perspective, as they are here at West Oahu. And they're ahead of us in terms of being at that next stage.
It Seems like a lot of people are listening to the press conference right now, because HPH's website, it currently says this page is not working, and then the state's website, the buttons aren't working. So it seems like a lot of people are trying to sign up. What safeguards, if you will, do you have in place to correct these and get these sites running as quickly as possible so people can get in there and make these appointments?
Well, I'm here at the press conference, and so I can assure you that my chief information officer knows that it's down, is waiting for my call to tell him to get it back up. So I imagine that there's a lot of folks working on this right now, because you know, I say that sort of jokingly, but the fact is we certainly recognize the importance of this. We know that there are a lot of people sort of just ready to go and excited about the possibility of getting a vaccine. So I'm sure our folks will have it up in a matter of a very short order.
And then yesterday we learned that someone on Maui was able to get a vaccine, and they were a visitor. They were from California. What safeguards are in place to make sure that the vaccines that are sent to Hawaii go to Hawaii residents?
Well, I know for us, you know, our intent is to do Hawaii residents, but as you also know, there are a lot of folks who are part-time in Hawaii, who consider Hawaii home, but they may spend time in other places. But if they're tourists, we're gonna ask them to go back to their home state and do it and not bomb to register. But if they confirmed a residence here in Hawaii, we're gonna go ahead and vaccinate them and get that done. Because, you know, again, the most important thing is, you know, you talked about Maui, somebody, you know, got vaccinated. The fact is there are a number of circumstances where people who are, you know, at the fringes of the phases may get vaccinated. I will tell you, if we finish a day and we've done everybody who has appointments and there's nobody else around that we can get who fits within that phase, and we have three doses left, we're going to give that dose to whoever will you know, bear their arm and allow us to vaccinate them. Because having, you know, a one-off or two-off or three people get a vaccine that is available rather than waste that vaccine, we think is consistent with the overarching goal, which is to get shots in arms.
We did have a couple remote questions sent in by KHON too. You mentioned targeted communication for kupuna. For those that need help registering online, or maybe they don't have an email address, will there be a phone line set up? What kind of services are there for kupuna?
We are planning a call center to provide support, and we do appreciate HMSA. They are supporting and working in collaboration. As you look at how we're putting the system together, and think of this as it's pandemic speed, which means we are working on the spot really rapidly to make sure that we can do this and do this well. And I truly appreciate other partners like HMSA offering to us some support so that we can increase the call centers and be able to make sure that the needs are met.
I should also add, our website's back working. So thank you for pointing that out.
And Sarah Madison at KHON2 wants to know if someone can go through logistics. Folks will need to find parking somewhere around here, or find parking at the Blaisdell, get out of their car, queue somewhere in here, and just if someone can explain that.
How you queue people through this? Well, we're going to do a tour too, right?
Yeah, we'll give a tour for how folks flow through this building. But as far as parking, and Dr. Ashton, correct me if I misstep, but we've got a lot of parking out here. We're going to have parking attendants through Elite Parking Services, a number of those folks helping to manage the flow as necessary. We also have overflow parking at Restaurant Row, Aloha Tower, and Topa. Okay, Aloha Tower and Restaurant Row. So we have a parking plan, and we'll be very well staffed to help manage the flow.
I don't want to take anything away from this facility or the Blaisdell, certainly, but I do want to add that this morning, Managing Director Formby and myself introduced to the governor our willingness to make Waipiho and other places possibly that the city controls available as well. So. To the logistics, if you will, but what we were told, and what everyone knows, and you heard it firsthand this morning, is that the administration of this vaccine is the logistics on it are challenging. But to the extent that that can get measured out, I want to say it again, the city will provide whatever resources and facilities to expedite and make things happen as efficiently and as aggressively as possible. Okay, thank you.
We're hopeful that this site and the Blaisdell site would serve as models for other sites, which is what the mayor is just talking about. It may not be at the same level, but we hope that this will set a framework for other sites to be established throughout our state. Are there any last questions? Because we wanted to do the tour, a quick walkthrough of the work area. Any last questions? Yes. I think Brooks can confirm the answer to that, but I don't think the Department of Health has made a decision yet. The CDC recommendations are just recommendations, and the State Health Department makes the final call on whether to adopt them.
This is on the CDC guidance on what the state's position is.
Okay. Thanks. Sorry, I got talking to another reporter on the side. Ron, I don't know if you want to chime in, but yeah, apparently the CDC has issued new guidance under the current administration, the Trump administration, for 65 and above. As you know, we just posted our executive summary of our vaccination plan just last Friday, and that is available again on HawaiiCovid19.com. It calls for the 65 and above to be in the next tier, not in the same tier as the 75 and above. So it's something that we will look at, but we have not yet altered our plans to prioritize 75 and above before the 65 and above, but it's something we'll look at.
Speaker, can I ask something?
Yep. Great.
I think those are the right questions. And again, Dr. Ashton, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think the way we're gonna progress through the phases is based on how the flow goes through the current phase that we're on. So right now for us, we're gonna use this site for the 75 and older and for finishing up the non-affiliated medical personnel and the designated essential personnel by the Department of Health. As we see those appointment requests begin to lag off, and where we see less people requesting appointments from those populations, we will be in conversations with Department of Health and saying, can we begin moving concurrently to the next phase? I can't speak for Queens Health System, but I suspect they will do the same. And frankly, I think you will see that happen on the neighbor islands and other places. So you will see various pods based on their regions and their demand moving through the phases in concert with guidance from Department of Health as we see the demand ebb and flow. And so it would do us no good right now to open up to the over 65 while we still have a significant number of over 75 population that we have to vaccinate. And so I'd ask you to help communicate that there is going to be this flow process based on demand as we work our way through the phases. And if one region or one neighbor island gets to a place where they're ready to move to the next phase quicker, all the better, because again, all we're trying to do is get shots in arms. So I hope that helps answer that question. Thanks.
Any last questions? So this site, Ray, this site opens on Monday at 8 a.m.?
8 a.m.
8 a.m.
Or by appointment only, but it's,
yeah.
I'm not supposed to say 8 a.m. or so.
All right, so thanks for joining us today. We're gonna do a really quick walkthrough for those who are interested of the work areas here. So thanks again, everybody.